Today we're opening up Trump's cabinet again and talking about probably the busiest man in the Trump administration right now, Robert Lighthizer. Haven't heard of him? Don't worry, his job would usually be pretty mundane.
The U.S. Senate has confirmed President Trump's nominee for U.S. Trade Representative, Robert Lighthizer.
Oh, you poor, poor man. Now that was announced a year ago, and being a trade representative probably sounded like one of the easiest jobs. Free trade agreements across the globe and a newly signed Trans-Pacific Partnership. It was about as smooth as the seas when the Titanic left. So, alright, as you can imagine, being in charge of tariffs right now would be like being in charge of herding mice in a snowstorm. So, who is this guy, besides the only person Canadians might actually be unpleasant to? Well, the good news is, he's been working in trade since the 1980s. In fact, he actually has quite the reputation in Japan, being nicknamed the Missile Man, no relation to Rocket Man. In 1985, he was negotiating steel tariffs with the Japanese trade representative, and so much didn't like Japan's proposal that he folded it into a paper airplane and threw it at the guy's face from across his desk. Man, that's so disrespectful to Japan, I bet even Logan Paul is cringing right now. I mean, it's Japan. You could have at least made it into an origami swan. I'll give you credit for confidence, though. Because with my paper airplane track record, it would have probably looped around and crashed somewhere behind me. And what kind of message would that send? Talk about turning from a power play into having to pick up some garbage behind you. Alright, so he's worked in trade for over 30 years. But hey Robert, what are you up to? Well, two things.
The administration has dispatched U.S. Trade Representative Robert Lighthizer to propose that a new NAFTA include lower trade deficits, eliminate unfair subsidies, end the dispute resolution panel, sunset the deal every 5 years pending reapproval, and update the rules of origin.
President Donald Trump is sending Treasury Secretary Steven Mnuchin and U.S. Trade Representative Robert Lighthizer to China for talks.
Wow, all right, you've got your work cut out for you. So, again, who is this guy? Well, at his core, he brings two key qualities to the job. He shares the president's skepticism of free trade, and he has decades of experience operating in Washington. Yeah, this guy hates free trade like it killed his father in the opening of a kung fu movie. And sending a guy who hates free trade into negotiating a free trade agreement, as you can probably imagine, is not going to end with an agreement. My question is, how did these North American free trade negotiations take so long? Mr. Lighthizer, do you want free trade with Canada and Mexico? No. Well then, let's just keep hanging out for a few months and bill our governments for this sweet Mexican vacation. I mean, the negotiations started in August and we were scheduled to have them end 4 months later on May 17th. But at that point, Representative Lighthizer warned, a deal was nowhere close. Yeah, no duh. You could give me decades debating the virtues of religious freedoms with Osama bin Laden, but I wouldn't hold my breath on a signed agreement. I mean, on day one of the negotiations, Representative Lighthizer was quoted as saying,
"We feel that NAFTA has fundamentally failed many, many Americans and needs major improvement."
Wow, tell me what you really think. Man, as soon as he dropped the F-bomb, negotiators should have known it was game over. I mean, you don't convince someone fundamentally opposed to something to agree to the thing by tweaking the corners. Steven, do you want to attend the Church of Scientology every week? No. Well, what if I told you we hand out donuts on Sundays? So, we launched into trade negotiations in August, which, okay, nothing scandalous there. But 2 months after negotiations started, the U.S. trade representative finally agreed on a list of demands. Now, just imagine that friend you've been trying to make plans with who keeps on saying, "I don't know, what do you want to do?" and rejecting all of your ideas. Except for 2 months. And an international treaty. This led to criticisms like, how can you launch talks to update a treaty and then make everyone wait months before you explain what you want? As the one Canadian official briefed on the talks. Ladies and gentlemen, our allies. Great, and when we finally presented our demands, they were worth the wait, because they were what US business groups labeled poison pills that threatened to derail the talks and prompt Trump to quit the pact. The key ones were a steep increase in regional automotive content requirements, a demand for half the value of North American vehicles to originate in the United States, and a requirement to renegotiate the pact every 5 years. You know, free trade stuff. Alright, but are those the poison pills we think they are? I mean, Canada's Minister on Foreign Affairs just said, Canada doesn't view trade surpluses or deficits as a primary measure of whether trade works. Well, isn't that convenient, because our president thinks they do. So, if you just want to fall into a trade deficit with us, we can all leave these negotiations that have been going on for over a year. Well, unfortunately, it's not that simple, because these countries believe in free trade, and the way Lighthizer approaches this trade deficit problem is through taking industry from other countries, rather than trying to grow industries and add value. Essentially, it would be like me demanding YouTube give me more money for my work, instead of trying to grow my channel and make more videos. Now, I'm not going to take a stand on who's right now, I just want to say that these views are incompatible with free trade, and the simple act of updating a trade treaty to include digital elements could, ironically enough, lead to a trade war. Now, Lighthizer is dealing with one other problem that is central to his ideology.
Trade tensions are heating up, the United States officially announcing a 25% tariff on $50 billion worth of Chinese goods containing, quote, industrially significant technologies. Beijing is vowing to respond swiftly to such actions, sparking fears of an all-out trade war. Joining me right now is U.S. Trade Representative Robert Lighthizer.
Yeah, no shocker here, but Lighthizer is not a big fan of the United States' current trade relationship with China, which is about as balanced as a drunk on a tightrope. Now, we recently went through a will-they-won't-they period on tariffs with China, and man was that a few fun days of reporting. Here's a summary of the tariffs. Uploaded. Oh, we came to an agreement. Here's a summary of that. Uploaded. Oh, we just pulled out of the agreement and put the tariffs back on. Great. Yes, we're boosting our trade barriers against China right now, too, because I think Lighthizer realized that if he just stops all international trade, well, then he can just coast through the next few years. China, funnily enough, is now getting consultation from an odd source on trying to figure out what the hell America's doing. Because it was recently announced that China, looking to its neighbor and rival Japan for insight, has been brought about by the pivotal role Lighthizer played in the US-Japan trade battles of more than three decades ago. Oh no, don't go to this guy for advice! Alright, so if China's looking back to the 1980s, why can't we? Stop me if this sounds familiar.
As Air Force One crosses the Pacific, sales of Japanese goods, such as cars and electronics, have swollen the trade deficit between the two countries to $20 billion a year in Japan's favor. Nearly one in four cars sold in the U.S. is Japanese. The media and Congress alike are howling for trade sanctions and tariffs against Japanese goods.
So, what did we do? Well, we essentially wrecked our economy for the next decade by flexing our trade muscles. A few things happened. First, in the Plaza Accords in September 1985, the US, Japan, France, West Germany, and Britain agreed to jointly intervene in foreign exchange markets to depreciate the US dollar against the Japanese yen. This was the geopolitical equivalent of, in a game of Monopoly, you and your friends all teaming up to take down the guy who just put a damn hotel on Boardwalk and Park Place, and needs to be taken down a notch. Now, this may sound odd, but having a valuable currency is terrible for your country's exports. Because if you're paying your workers 5,000 Monopoly dollars an hour, while another country has to pay their workers 15 US dollars an hour, guess whose things are going to be cheaper to make? So anyways, America and our allies agreed to forcefully value Japan's currency. And clearly China has taken note of this, because it was recently reported that Beijing is concerned that the EU might join forces with the US on trade issues. China is attempting to charm Europe with the right rhetoric on free trade. Nice try, China, but two can play at that game.
Two can play at that game. The warning from the EU pledging retaliatory strikes if President Trump goes ahead with plans to impose import tariffs on steel and aluminium.
Okay, Republicans, we can't keep trying to repeal Obamacare if we're just going to keep shooting ourselves in the foot like this. So maybe Europe won't be too enthusiastic about helping us push back China right now, considering we're also trying to push them back. But don't worry, that's not the only tool in our chest. Now listen to what Lighthizer said in his most recent interview.
On August the 14th, he said USTR studied this problem of technology transfer from China, of cyber theft of technology. We had a 7-month study. Then the president came out and he said he was going to put investment restrictions on. He was going to make us go to the WTO, which we did. And then he was going to put tariffs on certain high-tech goods in the amount of $50 billion.
No breaking news there, except that right now when people hear tariffs, they think of the blanket steel and aluminum tariffs that are driving so many countries crazy. But these are a whole new world of technology tariffs that are completely unrelated. Also, $50 billion might sound like the amount Hillary Clinton gets paid to speak at a Goldman Sachs event. I swear, once we get to talking about dollar amounts larger than a few million dollars, the best I can do is imagine a pallet of money slowly growing. But let me put it in perspective. That's about 9 times as much money as we're gonna use to fund the EPA next year, or a little over 2/3 of Puerto Rico's total debt. Lighthizer used a similar strategy in negotiating against the Japanese. We passed the Trade Act of 1974 specifically to deal with Japan, and as luck would have it, it seems to apply pretty well to our current China problem too. If you look at Section 301, it allows Robert Lighthizer's office, the United States Trade Representative, to issue a final determination on the products subject to the additional duties. This section basically says the president, as represented by the United States Trade Representative, can initiate an investigation and then negotiate a settlement with the foreign country in the form of compensation or elimination of the trade barrier. Now, in the 1980s, the United States launched more investigations into Japan than my freshman year college roommate. It was like imperialist Japan had conquered half of the dorm room. At the time, the senior counsel with the United States Department of Commerce said, Section 301 of the Trade Act of 1974 has become one of the most effective weapons that the US has in its negotiating arsenal to overcome the great reluctance of Japan to enter into trade agreements. Wow, I mean, it worked for us, but like, you're not supposed to say that on the record. Hey Robert, Japan doesn't want to enter into this unfair trade deal with us. Why don't you go investigate one of their thriving industries and see if we can change their mind a little bit? People are pointing out a few key differences between China and Japan right now though. Specifically that China isn't a US ally who pretty much depends on the United States for defense and trade. For example, exports to America account for less than 20% of China's exports, which is still a lot, but it's less than half of the percentage of Japan's exports during the time we're talking about. So, currently, we've launched the investigations, we've instituted the $50 billion in tariffs on machinery and Chinese technology, and all in the hopes that
it ends there, we can have negotiations and try to remove some of these structural barriers while at the same time opening up China. So, our hope is this is something that leads to good things.
Yes, let's hope it does lead to good things. In the meantime, that's the man behind the tariffs, and that's all I have to say about that. Hey YouTube, if you want to support independent journalism investigating Trump's cabinet, subscribe to our YouTube channel for our weekly episodes. And as always, thank you for watching.